Very good afternoon to all of you. And, on behalf of Sri Lanka Medical Association, I welcome all of you for this very important pre-conference workshop of the 133rd International Medical Congress of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. And just to brief you about Sri Lanka Medical Association, we are the oldest medical association and the most historical medical association in this Asia Pacific region. And during this month, we are having the 133rd anniversary International Medical Congress. And what we are having today is one of the pre-conference workshops, the second pre-conference workshop on microplastics in Sri Lanka and human health. Being the National Medical Association, we focus on the areas that are important to health of Sri Lanka and Sri Lankan citizens. And environmental health is one of such important and priority areas for us. Therefore, we are planning to have this second pre-conference workshop of our International Medical Congress on environmental health. And the topic that we are discussing today is microplastics in Sri Lanka and human health. And we have a galaxy of resource persons lined up today who have the expertise on the topic. And my co-resource person and co-chairperson is Dr. Sajith Edirisinghe, lecturer from the Faculty of Medical Sciences and also a council member of Sri Lanka Medical Association. He'll be conducting this session and he'll be introducing the other resource persons. Over to you, Dr. Sajith.
Thank you, sir. Before starting the session with this important topic on microplastics, I would like to give a small introduction regarding this, what is this microplastic, because a lot of school children and the parents are all watching. So, Vihanga, can you put the first presentation? Right, can you all hear me now? Yeah, right. Now, basically, for the people who are not familiar with the micro and the nano scale, though this diagram shows the basic information on the what is micro and the nano. So basically, we are going smaller and smaller scale for the nano and the microplastics. So the microplastics basically means the plastics which are less than 5 millimeters in size. So, Vihanga, can you move to the next one? Next slide, Vihanga. Right. So basically, so we are talking in microscopic level for the plastic scale, less than this red cell scale. Vihanga, the next one. So for the comparison, so when we take the diameter of the earth as 1 meter, so this glass bead, if we take the diameter, it's like a 1 nanometer. So a rubber ball of size of nearly 100 centimeters is in a size when we compare with the size of the diameter of the earth when we consider regarding the micro scale. So actually we are talking in micro and the nano. Again, apita ahata peyenne nathi ithamath kuda particles gana thama ada api katha karanda yan. So mokadda me microplastics and nanoplastics kiyala kiyan. Api ahaka dana plastic kala millimeter pahata wada kuda kotas walata kadunata passe තමයි අපි මේ මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික් ගණයට ඇතුල් වෙන්නේ. ඒක මිලිමීටර් ගානේ ඉඳලා ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැති මයික්‍රෝ සහ නැනෝ පාටිකල්ස් දක්වා යනවා. Next one. So අපි මේ ඉගෙන ගැනීමේ වර්ගීකරණයක් විදිහට අපි මේක කුඩා කොටස් දෙකකට කඩනවා. එකක් තමයි මේ ප්‍රාථමික මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා කියන එක සහ ද්විතීයික මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික්ස්. මේ ප්‍රාථමික මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා කියන්නේ ඒ කියන්නේ ෆැක්ටරි එකෙන් ප්‍රොඩක්ෂන් ලෙවල් එකේදීම මිලිමීටර 5ට වඩා අඩුවෙන් හදලා එවන ප්ලාස්ටික් කැපලි. ද්විතීක මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා කියන්නේ විශාල ප්ලාස්ටික් කොටස් පරිසරයේ තියෙනවා. ඒවා විවිධ පරිසර හේතු වලට එකතු වෙලා ඒවා කුඩා කොටස් වලට කැඩුනට පස්සේ ඒවා පරිසරයට එකතු වීම තමයි මේ සෙකන්ඩරි මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා කියන්නේ. උදාහරණයක් විදිහට මේ ප්‍රයිමරි මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් ගත්තොත් එහෙම සමහර අපි මූණ හොදන ෆේෂියල් ස්ක්‍රබින්ග්ස් වල ඉතාමත් කුඩා මේ පාටිකල්ස් තියෙනවා ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැති සහ ඉතාමත් මේ සියුම් මේ දත් බෙහෙත් වලත් තියෙනවා. ඒවා තමයි අපි මේ ප්‍රයිමරි මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් ගණයට ගණන් ගන්න. මේ ද්විතීක මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා කියන්නේ අපි කිසිම අනුදැනුමකින් තොරව හරි අපේ කිසිම පරිස්සමකින් තොරව අපි පරිසරයට නිකුත් කරන එලියට විසික් කරන මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් බෝතල් හිරු එලියට නිරාවරණය වෙලා වැස්සට නිරාවරණය වෙලා එහෙම නැත්නම් UV රේඩියේෂන් එකට නිරාවරණය වෙලා කුඩා කොටස් වලට කැඩෙනවා. එහෙම වාහනේ ටයර් වලට අහු වෙලා ඒ වගේ කුඩා කුඩා කොටස් වලට කැඩෙනවා. අන්න ඒ වලින් හැදෙන කුඩා අණු වලට තමයි අපි මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් කියලා සඳහන් කරන්නේ. අපි ගත්තොත් එහෙම 2018 වල Royal Statistical Society කියලා තියෙන විදිහට දැනට මුළු ලෝකෙම ප්‍රතිශක්තිකරණය එහෙම නැත්නම් රීසයිකලින් වලට යන්නේ 10%ටත් වඩා අඩු ප්ලාස්ටික් ප්‍රමාණයක් තමයි මේ මුළු ලෝකෙම ප්‍රතිශක්තිකරණයට යන්නේ. ඉතුරු 90%ම එක්ක පළවෙනි පාවිච්චියෙන් හරි එහෙම නැත්නම් repeated users ඒ කියන්නේ භාවිතා කීපයකට පස්සේ පරිසරයට බැහැර වෙනවා. දැන් මොකද්ද මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් වල තියෙන වැදගත්කම? ඇයි ඒක අපිට වැදගත් වෙන්නේ? මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් වැදගත් වෙන්නේ මොකද මේවා අන්තිමට මේ හුලඟට හරි වතුර වලට එකතු වෙලා හරි කාණු ඇලදොල හරහා ගමන් කරලා අන්තිමට ජලජ පරිසර වලට එකතු වුණාට පස්සේ මේ එක විදියක් විතරයි. ඒක අපිට ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැති කුඩා මත්ස්‍යයන් ආහාරයට ගන්නවා. අපි අර ඕ ලෙවල් සහ ඒ ලෙවල් පන්තිවල ඉගෙන ගන්න ආහාර දාමයේ දිගේ මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කැබලි එන්න 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 මේ ආහාර දාමයේ දිගේ එකතු වෙනවා ඉහළට. එහෙම එකතු වුණාට පස්සේ මොකද වෙන්නේ? අන්තිමට මේ මාළු අපි ආහාරයට ගත්තා මේ එක විදියක් විතරයි තාම කියන්නේ. තව බොන වතුර වලින් එහෙම වෙන්න පුළුවන්. එහෙම නැත්නම් හුස්ම ගන්නකොට හුලං මේ හුස්ම හරහා මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික් ඇඟට එන්න පුළුවන්. මේ එක විදියක් තමයි මේ අපි ගන්න ආහාර හරහා මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කොටස් අපේ ඇඟ ඇතුළට ඇතුල් වෙන්න පුළුවන්. මේ ඔයගොල්ලන්ට පේන්නේ මේ අන්වික්ෂ්‍ය දර්ශනයක්. මේ ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැති මුහුදු සත්වයන් මේ පෙන්වලා තියෙන්නේ. මේ ලා කොළපාට මේ ලුමිනස් කොළපාටනේ මේ පෙන්වලා තියෙන්නේ මේ සතුන් ආහාරයට ගත්ත ප්ලාස්ටික් කොටස්. ඒවා මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කොටස් තමයි මේ ලුමිනස් කොළපාටට අපි මේ පෙන්වලා තියෙන්නේ. ඒ කියන්නේ මේ සතුන් ඉතාමත් කුඩා මේ සතුන් අපිට ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැහැ. එහෙම පේන්නේ නැති වුනහම මේගොල්ලෝ ආහාරයට ගන්න. මේගොල්ලෝ තමයි ආහාර ධාමයක ප්‍රධාන ඒ කියන්නේ බේසික් ලෙවල් එකේ ඉන්න කොටස් විදියට සලකන. එතකොට ඒ වගේ කට්ටිය ඊට පස්සේ ටිකෙන් ටික මේ ඊට වඩා ඉහළ මත්ස්‍යයන් ආහාරයට ගත්තට පස්සේ මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් තොග පිටින් ඉහළ ආහාර ධාම වලට ගමන් කිරීමක් සිද්ධ වෙනවා. ඕගොල්ලෝ බැලුවොත් එහෙම මේ ෆුඩ් සිටි එකේ ලස්සනට මෙහෙම ෆුඩ් සිටිස් වල මෙහෙම ලස්සනට ගොඩ ගහලා තිබ්බට අපි හරියට බැලුවොත් එහෙම සමහර තැන්වල හැම මාළුවෙක්ගෙම දකින්න හම්බෙන්නේ නැතු ඇති. සමහර මත්ස්‍යන්ගේ බඩවල් විච්ඡේදනය කළ බැලුවොත් එහෙම මේ වගේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කොටස් දැක ගන්න පුළුවන් වෙනවා. විශේෂයෙන්ම අපි අඳින නයිලෝන් ඇඳුම් වලින් එක සේදුමකදී විශාල ප්‍රමාණයකින් මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කැඳි පරිසරයට නිකුත් වීමකුත් වෙනවා. ඒවත් මේ අන්වික්ෂ්‍ය දර්ශනයක් මේ පෙන්වලා තියෙන මේ කැඳි. අන්න ඒ වගේ ඒවත් මේ මත්ස්‍යයන් විසින් ආහාරයට අර ගැනීමක් සිද්ධ කරනවා. මේකෙන් පෙන්වන්නේ මේ කාසියත් එක්ක බැලුවොත් එහෙම මේ මිලිමීටර 1ක ප්‍රමාණය සහ මයික්‍රෝමීටර සහ මේ 100ක ප්‍රමාණය මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කැබලි. දැන් එතකොට මේ සත්‍යයට මේ මයික්‍රෝමීටර 100ේ පොඩි ප්ලාස්ටික් කැබල්ල පේන්නේ ඒගොල්ලෝ සාමාන්‍ය විදිහට ගන්න ආහාර කෑල්ලක් විදිහට. නැත්තම් මේ පල්ලෙහා පේන මයික්‍රෝමීටර 500ේ මේ කෙන්ද ප්ලාස්ටික් කෙන්ද පේන්නේ ඒගොල්ලෝ ආහාරයට ගන්න මේ පණුවෙක් විදිහට. එතකොට ඒගොල්ලෝ ඒව ආහාරයට ගත්තට පස්සේ මේක ක්‍රමානුකූලව ආහාර දාමේ ඉහළට ගමන් කිරීමක් සිද්ධ කරනවා. මේ තියෙන්නේ මේ චයිනාවල කරපු ස්ටඩි එකක්. මේ කඩලාන ආශ්‍රිතව කරපු ස්ටඩි එකක් මේ ඒගොල්ලොන්ගේ මේ මේ එක එක මත්ස්‍ය වර්ගවල මේ ග්‍රිල්ස් වල කර්මල් වල හිර වෙච්ච ඒවා බඩවැල් වල සහ ආමාශයේ කොච්චර දුරට මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කැබලි එකතු වෙලා තිබුණද කියලා මේ පබ්ලිෂ් මේ ඩේටා කවුරු හරි ඉන්ට්‍රස්ටඩ් නම් මේවට ගිහිල්ලා බලන්න මේ තියෙන මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් ෆ්‍රැග්මන්ට්ස් මේ චයිනා වල කඩලාන ආශ්‍රිතව කරපු සමීක්ෂණයක ප්‍රතිඵල තමයි මේ පෙන්වලා තියෙන්නේ. ලෝක සෞඛ්‍ය සංවිධානයනු පිටු 100 ගානක වාර්තාවක් නිකුත් කරලා තිනවා අපි බොන වතුරෙත් මේ ඉතාමත් කුඩා ප්ලාස්ටික් අන්තර්ගත වෙලා තියෙනවා කියන එක. ඒක ඉතාමත් විශාල ප්‍රශ්නයක්. මොකද දැන් අපි ඉස්සර කිව්වාගේ උණු කළ නිවල විතරක් බෑ උණු කළ නිවල පෙරලා බීම ඉතාමත් වැදගත් වෙනවා. මේකත් එක ස්ටඩි එකක් කරලා තියෙන ලෝකේ රටවල් 14කින් සාම්පල් අරගෙන තියෙනවා 150 ගානක්. ඒකෙනුත් 83%කම මේ සාම්පල් වල මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් අන්තර්ගත වෙලා තියෙනවා. අපි ඒ කියන්නේ ඔය මේ උත්සව වලට භාවිතා කරන ප්ලාස්ටික් බෝතල් ඇතුලේ බෝතල් කළ පානීය ජලය තුලත් මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් අන්තර්ගත වෙලා තියෙනවා. අපිට එළියට පෙවුනට මේ කිසි දෙයක් නැහැ කියලා. නමුත් ඇතුලේ අපිට ඇහැට පේන්නේ නැති සාමාන්‍ය ප්ලාස්ටික් අංශු මේ හරහා තැන්පත් වෙලා තියෙනවා. මේ තින් තව ස්ටඩි එකක් කරපො මේ ලෝකේ වතුර බෝතල් පානීය මේ බෝතල් කළ පානීය ජලය අරගෙන කළ තින් මේ ඉන්දියාවල චෙන්නයි මුම්බයි සහ දිල්ලි වල මේ තියෙන්නේ ඒ මේ එක එක තැන් වලින් අරගත්ත වතුර බෝතල් සල්ලි දීලා ගත්ත වතුර බෝතල් වල තියෙන ප්ලාස්ටික් අණු කොච්චර ප්‍රමාණයක් එකතු වෙලා තියෙනවද කියන එක. ඒ කියන්නේ මේ අපි මේ භාවිත කරන චීනේ ඊට පස්සේ තායිලන්තේ හැමතැනම ගන්න වතුර බෝතල් අපි බෝතල් කළ පානීය ජලය ගන්නකොට හොඳට තියෙනවා කියලා පෙනුණා. නමුත් ඒ ඇතුළෙත් මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් අන්තර්ගත වෙලා තියෙනවා. මේ නිව්කාසල් යුනිවර්සිටි ඕස්ට්‍රේලියා ඒකෙන් කරලා තියෙන සමීක්ෂණයකින් ඒගොල්ලෝ දල අගයක් දෙනවා. සාමාන්‍යයෙන් මේ වෙනසක් නැතුව ලොකු කුඩා වෙනසක් නැතුව සුමානයකට අපි සාමාන්‍යයෙන් ග්‍රෑම් 5කට ආසන්න ප්ලාස්ටික් ප්‍රමාණයක් ආහාරයට ගන්නවා. ඒ කියන්නේ අපි සල්ලි ගන්න ATM කාඩ් එකේ තියෙන ඒ ATM කාඩ් එකක ප්‍රමාණයක ප්ලාස්ටික් ප්‍රමාණය අපි මේ ආහාරයට ගැනීමක් සිද්ධ කරනවා සුමානයකට. මේක දලාගයක් විතරයි. මේකත් මේ නිව්කාසල් යුනිවර්සිටි එකෙන් පබ්ලිෂ් කරපු ඩේටා එකක තියෙන එක. බලන්න ඇමරිකාව සහ ඉන්දියාව මේ ආශ්‍රිත තියෙනේවල විශාල වශයෙන් මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික් අන්තර්ගත වෙලා තියෙනවා. මේ 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 රතු පාටින් ඩොට්ස් වල පෙන්වන්නේ average number of fibers per 500 ml. ඒ කියන්නේ මිලිලීටර 500ද fibers 4ක්. අන්න ඒ වගේ 4.8ක්. ඒ කියන්නේ ඉන්දියාවේ තියෙනවා. තාම ලංකාවේ ඩේටා එහෙම දීලා නැහැ. ඒ කියන්නේ ඉන්දියාවේ තියෙනවා කියන්නේ ලංකාවටත් ලොකු රිස්ක් එකක් ඒහා සමානවම තියෙනවා. ඇත්තටම අපි ඔය ආහාර ගන්නවා කියලා ඇත්තටම ගත්තට ඇත්තටම කැවිලා තියෙන්නේ ප්ලාස්ටික් විශාල ප්‍රමාණයෙන් තමයි මේ කැවිලා තියෙන්නේ. මේක ගණනය කරලා තිනවා 2025 විතර වෙනකොට the ocean will contain 1 metric ton of plastics for every 3 metric ton of fish. ඒ කියන්නේ metric ton 3කටම මාළු metric ton 3කටම හැම මාළු metric ton 3කටම plastic metric ton 1ක් මේ සාගරයේ තියෙනවා කියන එක මෙහෙම ගණනය කිරීම කරලා තියෙන අනුමාන ගණනය කිරීම. ඇයි අපි මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් වලට බය වෙන්න ඕනේ? මොකද මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික් හරියට නිකන් කාන්දමක් වගේ. යන එන එක හැම එකම එයා ඇදලා ගන්නවා ඇතුළට. ඒ කියන්නේ මේ වතුරට වැටුනහම මේ පරිසරයට නිකුත් කරපු මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් කෑලි ගහගෙන යනකොට මේක එකතු වෙනවා. ඒ කියන්නේ පරිසරයට අපි නිකුත් කරන කර්මාන්තශාලා වලින් නිකුත් කරන විස රසායනික ද්‍රව්‍ය තියෙනවා, බැර ලෝහ තියෙනවා. ඒ හැම එකක්ම මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික්ස් අණු ඇතුළට උරා ගැනීමක් සිදු කරනවා. එහෙම උරා ගත්තට පස්සේ හරි next one විහිඟ හරි මෙතන නිකල් තියෙනවා, ලෙඩ් තියෙනවා, තව බැර ලෝ මේ තව කිමිකල්ස් හුඟක් තියෙනවා, BPA තියෙනවා. මේ හුඟක් මේ මේක විශේෂයෙන් වැදගත් වෙන්නේ මේක කිමිකල්ස් උරා ගන්නත් පුළුවන් සහ මේ ප්ලාස්ටික් හදන්න භාවිත කරන කිමිකල්ස් උත් තියෙනවා. මේවා මොකද වෙන්නේ? ඊට පස්සේ අපි කෑවට පස්සේ අපේ ශරීරය හරහට ගිහිල්ලා මිනිස් ශරීරයේ තැන්පත් වෙලා මේ බැර ලෝහ සහ අනිකුත් රසායනික ද්‍රව්‍ය හිමීට පරිසරයට මුදා හැරීමක් සිදු කරනවා. ඒක තමයි මෙතන තියෙන භයානකම දේ. මේ උදාහරණයක් විදිහට මේව පෙන්වලා දීලා තියෙනවා. මේ BPA වල පියුරි පිළිකා එන්න පුළුවන්, EM වලින් පෙනහළු සහ ආමාශය පිළිකා, හරි මේ PHAs වලින් මේ මුත්‍රාශය ආහාර මාර්ගවල විශාල වශයෙන් පිළිකා දැන් ලංකාව ගත්තොත් දැන් ඉන්න ඉන්න පිළිකා පර්සන්ටේජ් එක වැඩි වෙනවා. ඉතින් සමහර කට්ටියද ජාන මේ සම්බන්ධතා තියෙන පුළුවන් සමහරලාට මේකත් එක හේතුවක් විය හැකි. මේ මේක අනිවාර්ය කරුණක් නෙමෙයි. නමුත් මේකත් විය හැකි. මේ ලංකාවේ තෙන්න එන්න පිළිකා වර්ධනය කියන්නේ මේ පුරස්ති ග්‍රන්ථි වෙන්න පුළුවන්. ඕවරිස් වල එහෙම නැත්නම් බකෝෂ වල පියවරු වල සහ මේ ආහාර මාර්ගයේ පිළිකා ඇතිවීමේ හැකියාවක් තියෙනවා. මේ තියෙන එක ස්ලයිඩ් එකක් මේකෙන් කරලා තියෙන්නේ අපි මේ රසායනාගාරයක් තුල ඉතාමත් කුඩා මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික්ස් අණු ආහාර සමග මිශ්‍ර කරලා මේ මීයොන්ට කන්න දීලා තියෙනවා. එතකොට මේ මයික්‍රෝමීටර්ස් 5 සහ මයික්‍රෝමීටර්ස් 20 ප්‍රමාණයේ කැමරට දීපු මයික්‍රෝප්ලාස්ටික්ස් මේ බන් මේගොල්ලොන්ගේ අරගෙන තියෙන අක්මාව වහුගඩුව සහ ආහාර මාර්ගය ගත්තොත් මේ කොළපාටට පෙන්වලා තියෙන ඩොට්ස් වගේ ඒවා ගිහිල්ලා මේ මේ ටිෂුස් වල තැම්පත් වෙලා තියෙනවා. එහෙම තැම්පත් වුණාට පස්සේ මම අර කලින් කිව්ව විදිහට ඒකට උරාගත්ත කිමිකල්ස් ටික හිමීට ඒ ටිෂුස් වලට මේ නිදහස් කරනවා. එහෙම නිදහස් වුණාට පස්සේ මොකද වෙන්නේ? එක එක කට්ටි එක එක පිළිකා එක්කෙනෙක් එනවා පෙනහල් පිළිකා වලින් තව එක්කෙනෙක් එනවා අක්මයි පිළිකා වලින්. එහෙම එක එක පිළිකා වලින් මේ ප්‍රසන්ට් වෙනවා. මේක නත් පොඩි සඳහනක් කරලා අපි සාකච්ඡාවට යමු. මේ පැසිෆික් සාගරයේ තියෙන ලොකු දූපතක් ප්ලාස්ටික් වලින් හැදිච්ච සිංගප්පූරුවේ ඇමරිකාවේ අතර ඇමරිකාවට කිට්ටුව තමයි තියෙන්නේ. ඒක සාමාන්‍යයෙන් බැලුවොත් එහෙනම් next slide ටෙක්සස් ප්‍රාන්තය වගේ දෙගුණයක් විශාලයි. ඒ කියන්නේ ලංකාව වගේ next slide විහිඟ 20 ගුණයක් විශාලයි. ඒක කොච්චර කල් යයිද දන්නේ ප්‍රත්‍යක්ෂණය කරලා ඉවර කරන්න. නමුත් ඒක විශාල ප්‍රශ්නයක් වෙලා තියෙනවා. රයිට් මේක මම බොහොම සරල අත දැක්වීමක් තමයි මේ මයික්‍රෝ ප්ලාස්ටික් සම්බන්ධයෙන් කරේ. අපි ඉස්සෙල්ලම අපි සාකච්ඡා වටේට යොමු වෙමු. The first speaker will be from NARA. Dr. Palitha Kitsiri, Deputy Director General, the Research and Development from the National Aquatic Resource and Research and Development Agency. Over to you, Dr. Kitsiri.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much for the Sri Lanka Medical Association to give me this opportunity to do a presentation on this analysis of our microplastic in Sri Lankan waters. Before starting the presentation, I would like to tell about the what is National Aquatic Resources Research and Development Agency, that is the research arm of the Ministry of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources Development Sri Lanka. We are conducting research on fisheries and also the aquatic resources. And in this presentation, I am planning to do this presentation on analysis of microplastics in Sri Lankan waters. Actually, this that results came from the survey conducted using the Dr. Fridtjof Nansen research vessel, Norwegian research vessel. We have conducted this survey in 2018. Next slide, please. Actually, the objectives of this study were to quantitative estimation of the abundance of microplastics in Sri Lankan waters, and assessment of their physical and chemical characteristics, and also the development of a guideline scientific base for plastic pollution control for the policy implementation in the country. And I think, as described by the Dr. Sajit, and then the overview of the microplastics, I would like to provide you some few characteristics. As he mentioned, small plastic pieces less than 5 millimeter in size, that is called microplastic, and also most prevalent type of marine debris, passive movements, and also the bioavailability and bioaccumulation processes also there, and ability to carry toxic chemicals as well as the bioaccumulation in the that human tissues and as well as in the other fauna tissues. Next one. When we think about the different categories of this origin, shapes and the sizes, and there are several type of categories based on the shape. One is pellets, the second one fragments and filaments, third one, and also I cannot see the below thing. And also this categories based on the particle size, less than 5 millimeter, that is called microplastic. 5 to 25, mesoplastic. Macroplastic, 25 to 100 millimeter. And megaplastic, more than 100 millimeter. And categories based on the origin, I think this has been also described by Dr. Sajid. Primary microplastic, that is plastic granules and pellets used industrially. And also the secondary plastic is all plastic particles produced by the degradation of the primary plastics. The next one, please. Now here, I am planning to present the results of our survey conducted in 2018. Dr. Fijap Nelson Bessel, that is very big research vessel with the old sophisticated facilities to do the scientific surveys in the ocean, the Norwegian vessel. We have a Norway-Sri Lanka bilateral program. Under this program, this vessel came to Sri Lanka in 2018 to mainly to do the fish stock assessment and have marine habitat mapping, and then this oceanographic studies and bathymetry, water quality, microplastic, and also microbial contaminated, including the heavy metals. I think you can see in this slide, we have started this survey from northern part of Sri Lanka, covering this northeast, central east, and southeast, and south, southwest, and also the northwest. The next one, please. Actually, in this survey, we have collected water samples in different type of methods. The first one we use is surface water sampling using manta trawling. That is the specific troll for collection of microplastic. The size of the measures, maybe around 335 micrometer, was used for the sampling. At the troll speed, we have to maintain the speed to collect the that samples there. Troll speed was the 2 to 3 knots. And also that time duration is 15 minutes continuously to the manta net, and also we collected the sample. Then the second one is surface water samples from this water pumping methods. And also in this method also we use 335 microns mesh size to collect the data. We have collected twice a day after pumping 1 hour water quantity into the mesh. The third one is we use this deep sampling samplers, CTD. CTD means conductivity, temperature, depth. Then there is a sophisticated equipment there. We can put this the equipment, CTD equipment, into the depth ranging from 100 meter, 1000 meter to 2000 meters. We have collected samples to do the microplastic analysis. These three methods we use. The first one is manta troll, the trolling method you can see in the picture here. The second one is pumping method. The third one is using CTD equipment to collect the sample in deep water areas. The next one, please. And also analysis of sample here, you can see the categories based on the shape, categories based on the size, and also categories based on origin. In that side, you can see see here the three methods we use for the collection of this microplastic. The first one, manta troll. The second one, water pump, and the CTD rosette. After collecting the water samples, we surface water samples, both manta troll and water pumps, we collected the surface water sample, both with sea water over a sieve of 180 microns, and observed under the dissective microscope, and particle size were identified, categorized, and photographed. Then some samples we send it to the Norway to do the analysis first, because we don't have the sophisticated equipment like FTIR. And then based on this dissecting microscope, using the dissecting microscope, we analyze the samples. The next one, please. You can see the summary of the collection analysis of samples. I am not going to read this in detail. The next one, please. Now here you can see the results part. In this slide, you can clearly see the area specific content of the microplastic. In this slide, you can clearly see that in northwestern province of Sri Lanka, coastal waters contain comparatively higher microplastic than the other areas. The west coast is more polluted than the east coast, and also the northwest highest abundance is 0.8 particle size. And also overall abundance in Sri Lanka is 0.02 particles per cubic meter. Here you can see the, according to the that region, the availability of number of plastics per cubic meter. The next one, please. In this slide, you can see the category distribution of this one. Okay, then in this slide you can see the categorical distribution of this one, and then according to the this slide, the percentage of that we have that plotted region against the percentage of microplastic, and you can see here this fragments and the that you call the foams and thread like plastics are more abundant than the other varieties. The majority of microplastics are fragments, and the pellets are the least found category. Pellets means the primary type of microplastic, and also this the most abundant are the fragments and also the that thread light microplastic categories. Next one, please. And the category distribution here also you can see the northeast, central, east, southeast, southern, southwest, and northwest. It was found that the northwestern region fragments, as I mentioned you earlier, contain the highest highest concentration of microplastic in the northwestern area. That is fragment type of microplastic. The major I mentioned here also the category composition vary by the region. This may be due to this northwestern region. Why this one? From maybe Chilau to Putlam area, but what was the reason for that one? The reason was due to the current situation and also the shallowness of the water condition in that those areas tend to accumulate more microplastic than other areas. I think you can see here the southern part of Sri Lanka has the less microplastic contents because there is a water moving, water currents, and also there is a very good mixing process due to the that sea condition there. But in the northwestern part of Sri Lanka, the main reason is due to the current patterns, due to this shallowness of that one, all this plastic accumulated in the northwestern part of the coastal waters of Sri Lanka. Next one, please. Then this color composition. Actually, as far as the color is concerned, here also you can see the blue and also this maybe black color sometimes is dominated that as far as the microplastics are concerned. Why this is one is actually mainly the fishermen generally microplastic are mainly coming from different sources. The one source is fishing nets and also the that other type of fishing gears. Mainly this the fishermen they use blue color fishing nets and as well as the black color because they are using to get the highest harvest because this type of colors fishers cannot see these colors and then they want to catch much fish and they are using this different type of color mainly blue and also the black color. Next one, please. As far as the surface properties are concerned, here you can see the surface properties smooth or rough condition. Then according to our analysis, 37.33% that is smooth plastic and also rough plastic 62.67, and hardness soft 49% and hard 50.4%. These are according to the surface properties as well as the hardness of the microplastic. The next one, please. When we see the images of this one, we found different size of categories from less than 0.1 millimeter to over 30 millimeter. Different surface properties, rough, notable, trenches are only smooth. Different type of that surface conditions also be observed. Next one, please. Here you can see the few images of this different type of plastic collected during the surveys. Next one, please. When we think about the geometric shapes, that is, these are the irregular type is more abundant. That is 74% 1-3. Filament types, the next type is 24% 5-3, and others are less amount. The most available is irregular shape, that microplastics. The next one, please. Here you can see the number of particles against the classes, the size of the microplastic, width, and also the length. The most abundant particles range from 0 to 0.5 millimeter. Here you can see the 168 numbers. And also, as far as the length is concerned, 0.2 to 4.1 millimeter length size is most abundant plastic we found during the survey. The next one, please. As I mentioned earlier, then we have carried out two type of sampling methods. One is the mantra trolling sampling. The second one is pumping boat sample and collect the microplastic. According to that study, the pumping study, you can see here that that is also the same results came as in the mantra troll. Northwestern province coastal region, that the marine waters contain highest microplastic compared to other regions. Here also you can see the less from northeast and also the southern part of Sri Lanka. The mostly do that northwestern province of the Sri Lanka, especially the coastal and marine waters, as I mentioned, due to the current pattern as well as the accumulation is more in this area compared to other areas due to this that current pattern and also the depth and also the other type of parameters. The next one, please. And chemical composition, you can see here different type of chemical composition. We have observed six types. I am not polypropylene, polyethylene, like that. I'm not going to provide in details because according to our survey, we have found these six number of chemical categories. The next one, please. When we see the conclusion and recommendation, the waters around Sri Lanka are contaminated with the microplastic. The vast majority secondary category indicating that the packing material, industrial application, and fishing gear are a major reason. The survey covered a particular season of the year. Actually, we conducted this survey from 2018, June, 21 days in the sea, but we collected sample only during that period, and then we cannot tell about the that all situation in the that marine and coastal also because of we collected within a limited time period. And also next year also we are planning to conduct the same survey around Sri Lanka to compare the situation, not only this microplastic with the other that fisheries resources and other parameters also. And this spatial variations in the distribution of plastic particles with regard to the abundance of fishing harbors, popular tourist destination, river openings, and the coastal currents prominent in certain areas may be studied. Research on effect of microplastic ecosystem component is also suggested in this that study. And also at present, NARA is conducting research on this microplastic, especially in the microplastic in fauna, especially in fisheries, that fish species. Now we are conducting. Next slide, please. That ongoing work, as I mentioned you, we are continuously conducting the study on microplastic in different fauna, especially in fish samples. One of the students conducted one research program under that her MSc thesis. She found that she actually selected two species. One is Amblygastes, that is Hurulla, and also this the second one is Sardinella gibbosa, that is called Salia species. And that she carried out collected samples from different locations of Sri Lanka, Trincomalee, and also Nigambu and Mirissa. Then and she found that 90% of the samples in Trincomalee and Nigambu, around 100%, has this, she found this microplastic inside the gut of the species. And the Sardinella species also, she found that around 90-95% of the fish collected from the that areas also contain the microplastic, and then here you can imagine the, how dangerous is microplastic now if we do not stop the that use of plastic. And then in future, there will be more, as Dr. Sajid said, there will be more that cancer cases and also maybe more deaths. And then we have to take necessary steps to minimize the use of microplastic. At present, the Ministry of Fisheries, Department of Fisheries, we ban bringing these small bottles to the with the fishing vessels, especially the bottles less than 5 liter. That department has, the fisheries department already banned to restrict the plastic bringing into the sea. Okay, that is my presentation. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kitsiri, for your valuable information. Before moving on to the next speaker, I would like to ask a small question from you.
Yes.
What is the contribution from the land-based, that like the straws, the plastic straws and everything, for the microplastic contribution, the percentage from the land-based to the microplastics in Sri Lanka?
No, actually, still we haven't calculated this one, but the research is going on. Yeah, that okay. Identify different locations. For example, we are conducting this sort of survey from the Kallan River, across the Kallan River, getting the sample within 1 hour period, how much we are getting, and then we categorize into different categories. A study is going on.
Okay, right. Thank you. We'll move on to the next speaker. The next speaker is Dr. M.F.M. Fairoz, the Dean, the Faculty of Fisheries and the Ocean Sciences, the Ocean University of Sri Lanka. Over to you, Dr. Fairoz.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I would like to thank for Sri Lanka Medical Association for this opportunity. And I am welcoming all of you to this session. And I am following up actually the talk delivered by Dr. Palitha Kitsiri from NARA, and also the introduction followed by Dr. Sajit Edirisinghe. And my talk title will be the introduction to marine pollution and its effects on marine environment, because as Ocean University, please move to the next slide. So. And I would like to give some of the introduction of our university. Actually, we have the vision to become a leader to develop human resources on fisheries and marine sciences and technology in this region. And so this is part of actually this kind of workshops we have to take part, and knowledge dissemination and research is part of our university. So that is why I introduced our institute. So on behalf of the university, I would like to again thank to the Medical Association giving this opportunity. So my talk actually would focus on more educational aspect as well as some of the research initiative existing in Sri Lanka as well as from our institute and the outside scientist from Sri Lanka. Next slide, please. So what we have to, in generally, we have to think our ocean, because as a ocean nation, like island nation in the Indian subcontinent, in the Indian Ocean, we have the largest mammal on land and we have the largest mammal on vicinity of our ocean. So we are blessed with the biodiversity for this island and Sri Lanka. So we have to think about how we should conserve the biodiversity as well as to keep the human health in function in the proper way. So that is very important, I think. So we have faced a global pandemic. Locally, we have affected, we have understood, we have reacted, we are following up. So, but we also have to think about the environment and also the degradation of the environment, how we should mitigate, what the educational aspects that we are taking up, and also what are the research we are incorporating into our knowledge and to maintain our educational system. So that is what I want to look at, this plastic pollution in that angle, and I will follow up the rest of the slides and deliver my points of view. Please go to the next slide, please. So just to give you an idea, why, what is this marine pollution? Because we are thinking the ocean side as our institute, and also the part of the Indian Ocean, so we have biggest area in the ocean. So we should think about what kind of definition stand for marine pollution. So because any chemical material which comes to ocean as a combination, we call pollution. So it results very reversible and non-reversible damage to environment. So we have to keep in mind about this aspect while studying and also gaining knowledge. Next slide, please. So I pull up some basic causes like sewage, toxic chemicals from industries, and land runoff, and also large oil spills, which I have put some background pictures here, and also ocean mining. We are not so much affected on that. Littering. So some of the facts that I have listed here that we are already in practice, we can see as causes or supporting practices that we are in this island, we are on practice. So that need to keep in mind anytime that before going to think on the plastics or sewage pollution. Next slide, please. So what this term plastic stands for? Because Dr. Edirisinghe pointed out medical focal or angle why these chemicals go in the residual impact into the biology and comes to human. So I don't want to talk in the medical side, but however, we have to think about the food web and the food chain. And that is the running or the energy system which circulating the biological productivity into the human as well as the other animals in the maintaining the global biogeochemical cycle. So it's a pollution is a part of the pollution comes with a chemical material. So we should have to have an understanding of what this polythene means and the molecules and what kind of detail in that in general. So next slide, please. So apart from this chemical introduction into the environment, what the other factor affecting to the human health as well as our population? So our population now it's more than 20 million and it's increasing from the last decades to the present. It's increasing. Also non-communicable diseases also increasing as evidence. There are research ongoing in the medical aspect. That is actually showing us some direction of rapid population growth and urbanization plus the industrial growth have severe problems, or we call acute or chronic situations coupling up with this plastic pollution. So that we have to keep in mind, and with that we call collaterally food habits, traditions, lifestyles, and the climate is also supporting to these effects. Next slides, please. Thank you. Just because that Dr. Keith Seary also introduced some of the research finding on the classification types, but I am going to show some of the generalized classification to give you a pick up what kind of dominant waste plastics that we are in use in the chips and confectionery bags. 18.6% are given in here. So that's what we have. We are evidencing every time. If you go for a walk in the beach, you will see or pick up these chips and confectionery bags in plenty of places. So this is actually we have to think about. Come to home. I am not going to tell what we have to do, but you have to think about what we observe. So then try to come to an analysis or time to come to a conclusion to think about an attitudinal change. That is the message. That is our education. So we have to think that nature to come up with this prior to the human health issue. Thank you. Can you go to the next slide, please? So I just wanted to give about the types of plastic materials for the beginners or some general community. So unfortunately, I should have prepared this slide in Sinhala, and I could deliver some words in Sinhala as well. But however, so just I follow up the way that I prepared. So you see the 80% are thermoplastics. That stands for thermoplastic materials. They are bent or just pressurized to become different various forms, like for the drink, like PET bottles to various containers. So that's how it's made up. So 80%. So we have to think about that's very much common in use nowadays. Next slide, please. So then the general community also have to think about categories, what kind of reusable. So as much as we have to think about reusable materials, so just to keep them in a safe way and reuse, but we have to avoid some of the dangerous items. For example, safe food containers are made from number 1, 2, 4, 5 and 4, 5 plastics. So others need to be avoided. So that kind of awareness, understanding to be bear in mind while we use it. So then we can mitigate some of the health and health problems to human as to the biodiversity as well. Thank you. So next slide, please. So just to, because it's already discussed, so just what the words, terminology, what kind of this sizes of plastic. So the microplastics are most of the debatable topic at the moment. So it's very important therefore important to have an understanding on the size. The size becoming smaller or at the origin or in the later part of a successional series or the degradation, it can happen. So it's there are several ways of how this can be originated. So example is directly we use some microplastics or it comes as an oxidation process. So that we have to keep in mind. Next slide, please. So these are some of the common observation residues and results that we can see. If we take a sample, we can see this kind of observation. So there are like primary, secondary plastics according to the type of degradation or the abundance. Next slide, please. So just I pull up some of the this general output which comes from the world ocean, our world ocean data, which is showing not only to Sri Lanka, in the global scale, the pathway Because it shows that the plastic inputs to the ocean 8 million tons per year. So this is not simple. This is very serious. 2 billion people living in the coastline. So this is a problem with the coastal zone managers, and the management and the policy implementation. That we have to keep in mind. This is already evidence. So we have to have a dramatic attitudinal change toward the plastics. Otherwise, we would be in trouble. Our biodiversity would be in serious trouble. The food web will be in serious trouble. Human, it will come back to the human health. That's a challenge. Next slide, please. So then I just wanted to highlight what my subject, how that comes to the microplastics. So I put the microplastic in the word, it's less than like a micrometer to 500 micrometer size. So just I wanted to you to focus on the marine biota. So that is our area. Actually, that all other things, sources and control measures, some of the management and the origin and their status, it comes in this line. And the marine biota, just think about corals. This is one of my fascinating area of science. Corals are very much dominant in this island. We have about 150 odd genera and several species representing them. And they are being subjected to degradation in the last decades due to various impacts plus pollution. So we have to maintain the biodiversity. The biodiversity is sheltered like the areas like coral reefs, because coral reefs provides enormous amount of shelter or to maintain the other organisms associated. So it's like a supermarket, actually, the natural supermarket. So that has a lot of energy. Primary productivity is about gram carbon square meter per year. It's about 2000 gram carbon. That is equivalent to tropical rainforest. So it's kind of a very important ecosystem that we have in Sri Lanka. So we have to think about it. And Dr. Edirsinghe mentioned about the zooplanktons. We have seen some of the plastic, microplastics were accumulated in the fluorescence photography. So, and also phytoplanktons, benthic organism, fishes, we all often eat, because island nation, that is one of our standing point of floating source for our, to maintain our human health. So that's very important. So seabirds, large mammals like whales, that's what I said, we have blessed with the largest mammal in our island, associated in the Indian Ocean, as well as on land, elephant. So that now you can see the difference when where we are at. Next slide, please. So then just some typical existing system. So we have to think about whether we have this technology, whether we have implemented or not, how the policy. And then I just pull up some diagrammatic representation of domestic sewage, industrial sewage type towards the plastic from the Conservation World Conservation Union. Next slide, please. And then the impacts I already have mentioned, and you can see the planktons with the fluorescent image with the microplastic. So that's already Dr. Edirsinghe mentioned. So next slide, please. So you can see some of the evidence that scientists found. Actually, I pull out these images from these people published with their respective. So I want to tribute for these pictures. Next slide, please. And then how these plastics accumulated in different levels in the food web. That is what my intention to presenting this slide. Next slide, please. And so this is what I have found one of the very nice study at the primary level, take part in the southern coast of Sri Lanka. So that they are showing that what the water column and in the beach, how much microplastic abundance. So can I go to the next slide, please? And this actually showing what the average microplastic counts in 20 meters in the water as well as in the sand. So these are the some of the results with the permission of the authors I present here. Next slide, please. So that's with my subject area, I just wanted to look at this aspect, how this is related with the energy system, with the primary productivity and the energy flow through ecosystems and maintenance this component in the system biologic approach. So then how we think about source and sink of chemical components as biomass or inorganic or organic forms. This is the point I am looking in the organic form. So that is what I mentioned. I put up some bacteria and the viruses apart from the next level to plankton. So because the marine bacteria and the marine viruses are global biogeochemical, the largest biogeochemical entities in this world. Because if you don't know, please understand 1 milliliter of seawater, 1 million bacteria. So they are actually supporting larger amount of microbes. Marine microbes are not harmful. They are very much favoring to maintain our ecosystem, the global cycling. So therefore, but we have to not to forget certain bacteria and viruses are harmful. They may be come back to cause human disease at secondary level, first at wildlife level, wildlife diseases. That is what we are evidencing. For example, Vibrio is a genera, is alpha proteobacteria, and they are actually in the seawater. So they are actually maintained by this system. So I am not going to talk much, but we can discuss later. Thank you. I'll go for the next slide. So some of our stations for this kind of hypothesis that we are working on, some of my study sites here with my group. And next slide, please. So we have think about this microbialization coupling with the pollution. So we have published already some of the work, including Sri Lanka and other parts of the world, including Pacific Island and the Atlantic and the Caribbean. Next slides, please. And it's very complicated, actually. If we do research with this food web dynamics, coupling with the pollution and their chemical interaction, I put up some arrows. You can see it's a very complicated. We have proposed, actually, this one. So we are trying to take an image and a kind of a modeling how this can actually interact and how what kind of lessons we can learn to produce biotechnologically produce some chemical components like antibiotics, etc. Next slide, please. Yeah, so I almost finished. So thank you very much for your attention. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Fires. I would like to ask a small question from you. Do we have a small or some sort of an idea how much of plastic waste that we are receiving or washed to our Sri Lankan beach from abroad? Do we have a rough idea or a percentage or anything?
Not really, but we are in general, because specifically I can't say without any proper research statistical data. In general, according to the topography and the location of the Indian Ocean, the Sri Lanka is actually interacting the Bay of Bengal large region. It is influenced by various oceans from the Middle East side and in the eastern side from Bay of Bengal and also other countries. So I think the currents and the regime, wind circulation patterns would be more influencing on that. So still we don't know where the sources and whether it is from our local internal circulation or whether it is coming from outside. There should be a balance, some budget. So I think Dr. Pal is the also the, his data set also show some trends, but I think further research is needed to give some concrete idea on that. So I think multinational project.
Thank you, Dr. Pyrus. Our next speaker is Mr. N.S. Gamage, the Director Investigation from the Central Environmental Authority. Over to you, Mr. Gamage. Until Mr. Gamage comes online, we'll move to Dr. Madhura Vellaheva, the Additional Secretary, the Planning and Performance of the Review, Ministry of Education. Dr. Madhura.
Yes.
Yeah, Dr. Madhura, we warmly welcome you. Can you give a brief introduction?
Yeah.
What is the Education Ministry's role about this banning of the pollution plastic bringing into the schools, and what are the rules and regulations are established at the moment at the school level?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Sajit, for the invitation, and also I must appreciate the Sri Lanka Medical Association's efforts to educate the people and also gather the knowledge created or found elsewhere with regard to this kind of an important topic, and also for the invitation extended to us. And here, as the Ministry of Education, actually, we are treating around 4 million children within the government schools. It's not around, actually, it's little more than 4 million children. And when it comes to the private schools, international schools, and all the children who are studying in this country, plus the universities, it will go up to 5 million, which means actually like 20 to 25% of the total population of the country. So I think rather than, sharing the knowledge about the measures, I would like to start with some of my ideas towards what actually as adults we have to do in order to, safeguard the lives of the children of the country. Because when it comes to the school children, actually they are, we were talking of the consumption of the plastics per week by a person, average person. I think when it comes to children, they may be consuming from their little age, even more than an adult, plastic, plastic within a week or a day or a month. So this needs to be taken into consideration. So within the school system, we are facing with more challenges because the children has to, they have to take their water in a container and carry their food in a container. And sometimes they are given with some, food from the outside using plastics. So most of the times actually they bring the water in a plastic container and also food in a plastic container. So these are the major issues that we have confronted with. Even the lunch sheet issue is a big problem, I think, in Sri Lanka, and where we don't see in the rest of the countries of the world. I don't know to what extent we have been, used to it. So this is a very vulnerable circumstance that we are facing. So the Ministry of Education has now taken action to educate parents and the teachers, and through them the children, to not to use, to avoid to the level best, the use of the lunch sheets, and instead carry their food in a container. suitable container and the water as well as in a bottle with this the plastic, you know, the gauging numbers like 4, 5, 6 etc. But the case is actually they are not modeled by the best practices elsewhere. I mean, out of the schools most of the times. And also, we never know the drinking waters that they consume within the school, within the home, wherever, what extent they are contaminated with the microplastics. So these are the issues that we are confronting with everyday life, in our everyday life. So one more thing is actually the schools actually, most of the schools are having better drinking water, good quality drinking water. I think, I mean, around 400, 500 schools may not have pipe-borne or, you know, ground water in their schools. But those schools are provided with drinking water somehow or the other by the school managements and the education management. The case is, now, when I move back to the topic, I mean, the topic that we are discussing today is the issue of the microplastics. So when this comes to the scene, we never know in which areas the concentration of the microplastics are high and where this is, I mean, this can be considered as no issue. Listening to the presentation shared by the NARA and the Ocean University, I'm actually a bit hesitated to know that this much of an issue is prevailing in the country at the moment. So the children are always actually following their adults. So the schools actually can be, you know, forcefully we can actually administer some rules and guidelines to, I mean, for them to stipulate with. But to what extent these practices will be, you know, taken onto the ground will be decided at the end of the day by the practices, by the experiences they are getting, you know, they are receiving outside the school. So this is the problem, to my knowledge. But fortunately, we have kind of, you know, best literacy rate in the world compared to the other countries, rest of the world. It's like 83% something in the country, the world average. But here we have 92% something literacy rate. And also, fortunately, we are having, more than 85% of the children, school-going age children in the schools. They are coming to the school. And also, we have a good amount of teachers and the school managers. If we can actually take some specific actions to educate this community, the school community, that will in one way help educate the general public or the society at large through them. I mean, we can take some measures. But on the other hand, actually through media and also through fora like this, and also maybe using any other possible, you know, measures, if the people who have been researching on that and actually who have the knowledge, better knowledge than the other people, the rest of the general, you know, ordinary people, can come together and educate the government sector, the school education sector, especially through the Ministry of Education, maybe we will be always there to, you know, take those guidelines with due regard. So if that kind of an awareness campaign is a very necessary, very essential thing, as I believe. Otherwise, I don't know whether ordinary people will win, will be, you know, will adhere to, the guidelines, because that has to be a practice. I mean, that needs to be, you know, inculcated in our culture. So this is what I wanted to share at the beginning. I'm not actually elaborating on a scientific, you know, research or a finding or a, you know, kind of, you know, factual information I'm not sharing, but at large, I think we have to take some measures immediately as the government sector, as well as the other sectors who are actually supplementing with their, you know, new knowledges. We need to come together and identify some, you know, kind of strong measures which can be implemented and introduced and implemented by the organizations, the government organizations, maybe private organizations, of course, including the schools, to avoid our maybe negative practices, to safeguard the earth and the waters and the environment and the air. So this is the idea that I wanted to share, because actually not only the plastics, we know the chemicals also are doing more hazardous impact. And what we hear now recently also regarding a glyphosate impact, we saw in the papers that what has happened in the States. So these things also need to be considered. I think the Sri Lanka Medical Association can take some further steps to have a collaborative effort, establish a collaborative effort, and thereby to take collective measures to educate all the communities, not only the schools, and through those communities to educate the outside the school communities to model good practices, and then it'll actually enlighten the school sector. And eventually the school children also will take up with these, good practices.
Thank you, Dr. Madhura. And from as SLMA, we are very happy to collaborate with the Ministry of Education and the Environment Department, Ministry, and the NARA and Central Environmental Authority will join everybody together. And if there is a possibility, the SLMA to come to the schools as doctors, and we can provide some guidance, and we can give some practical aspects how to prevent and what are the health issues that we are having regarding these plastic issues by combining with all the authorities responsible for this plastic management. So we are very happy to come and help the education ministry to go ahead with to fight against this plastic battle. Right, our next speaker is from the Central Environmental Authority, Mr. N.S. Gamage. Mr. Gamage, it's over to you. He's from Central Environmental Authority.
Yeah.
We welcome you, Mr. Gamage. Yes, we can hear you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Actually, I must thank for the interaction, and also at the outset, I would like to thank Sri Lanka Medical Association and its President, Professor Indika Karunathilaka, and all the staff there for inviting the Central Environment Authority to join this timely, important webinar on plastic, microplastic issue. And as the Central Environment Authority, so that my topic is of course, today, the legal aspect of controlling microplastics and the single-use plastics. So, in my presentation, I would like to briefly discuss on a regulatory framework on single-use plastic and microplastic control, implementation aspect of those regulations, and support services of the Central Environment Authority for recycling post-consumer plastic waste. And also the National Action Plan for Plastic Waste Management also will be discussed. And finally, I would like to share with you on further action to strengthen the existing legal provisions for controlling single-use plastic and the microplastics. So the issue, of course, issue on the microplastic, of course, has already been discussed by the former speakers. However, in general, Sri Lanka generates nearly 600 tons of plastic waste per day, and of which 180 tons are packaging materials, as per the data available in the Central Environmental Authority. And also, it has been reported that approximately 20 million lunch sheets and 50 million plastic shopping bags are thrown into the environment daily. Those are actually considered as single-use plastic items, the plastic bags and the plastic polythene lunch sheets. And another 100 tons of PET bottles are also adding into the environment without any kind of a recycling or reusing process. And however, and the amount of plastic, primary plastic materials imported to the country is nearly 0.5 million tons per year. Those are the few figures with regard to the plastic pollution in the country. And next slide, please. The main provisions of this plastic control are available in the National Environmental Act. The National Environment Act was enacted in 1980 by Act No. 47, and thereby the Central Environment Authority was established in 1981. And the Central Environment Authority is basically a regulatory agency which provides certain provisions for the protection, management, and enhancement of the environment, and also for regulation and maintenance and control of the quality of the environment, also prevention and for the abatement of pollution, and to make matters connected with that. In addition, we are conducting environment education and awareness programs as well. So that with that legal background, of course, the next slide, please. The Central Environment Authority has certain powers vested through that act that is available under Section 23W. Thereby, the minister in charge of the environment has been empowered to publish orders to prohibit the use of any material from any process, trade or industry, and also prohibit, whether by description of or by brand name, the use of any equipment or industrial plant which will endanger the quality of the environment. And also, the minister may be ordered publishing the gazette notification requiring the installation, repairing, maintenance or operation any equipment or industrial plant within the areas specified in the order. So those are the legal provisions available in the National Environmental Act to control the single-use plastics and as well as the microplastics. So with that legal provision, next slide please. With that legal provision, the Central Environment Authority took action to publish several important regulations in 2017 September. That is mainly focusing the single-use plastic items which are being used in the country without any control and discarding into the environment without concerning the environment consequences such as ocean plastic pollution as well as the microplastic pollution. This single-use plastic, of course, creates secondary micropollutants than the primary pollutants. However, the controlling efforts of the Central Environment Authority began the implementation of these six regulations. The first one is number 2034/33, that is to prohibit the manufacture of polythene or any polythene product of 20 micron or below in thickness for in-country use, as well as sale, offer for sale, offer free of charge, exhibition or use of such polythene film products which are below 20 micron has been already prohibited by that particular regulation. And however, those certain limited purposes, it has been allowed, such as laminating processes and also medical and pharmaceutical purposes. So where there is no other, any other alternative. And the next regulation is number 2034/34, that is to prohibit the manufacture of food wrappers, in the sense the lunch sheet, from polythene as a raw material for in-country use, and also the sale or for sale or for free of charge exhibition and use of such polythene lunch sheet also has been prohibited by that particular regulation. Next slide, please. And again, the another regulation was published, that is bearing number 2034/35, that is to prohibit manufacture of any bag from high density polyethylene as a raw material for in-country use, and again sale or for sale free of charge issue, exhibition or use of such high density polyethylene bags has been already been prohibited by that particular gazette notification. And also then another gazette notification has also been published to control the air pollution caused by plastic burning. Thereby, no person shall burn openly or cause to burn, allow or permit to burn of refuse or other combustible matters inclusive of plastics. Not only the plastics, all the combustible matters which inclusive of plastic has been banned for burning. That is to actually not directly related to the micro polluters, but to control the air pollution because of this burning plastic items. Next one, and the next regulation is bearing number 2034/37, that is to prohibit use of all forms of polythene, polypropylene, polyethylene products or polypropylene products as a decoration in political, social, religious, national and cultural or any other event or occasion. So we Sri Lankan experience during political campaigns, we noted that a lot of polythene materials are used for decorative purposes in political rallies. However, with the implementation of this regulation, we are experiencing less amount of polythene materials are using for decorative purposes. But still, we are noticing that for certain limited activities, such polythene products are being used. But CA is taking legal action on such occasions. And also next one is, next regulation is bearing number 2034/38, that is to prohibit manufacture of food containers, plates, cups and spoons from expanded polystyrene for in-country use. That is the expanded polystyrene means, since that the regiform, in general we call it regiform, and sale, offer for sale, offer free of charge, exhibition no. Use of food containers, plates, cups and spoons manufactured from expanded polystyrene within the country. So in our country, only one factory was being operated for manufacturing of such food containers, food lunch boxes made of regiform. That publication of the regulation, that factory has to close down their operations. Now there are no more such regiform food boxes or plates or some other cutleries made of regiform in the country. Next slide, please. And those regulations were implemented since January 2008, after granting a certain period for the consumers as well as the traders and the manufacturers to adhere to those regulations. And then CA launched that iron white radium program for implementation of these regulations with the assistance of Consumer Affairs Authority and the Sri Lanka Police. The Central Environment Authority has regional and district wise officers in all the districts and all the regions, and as well as in the head office there is a special unit called the investigation unit, and all these officers are conducting raids island-wide to seize the products as well as to bring the offenders to the courts. Illegal products are being seized under the Consumer Affairs Authority Act and produced to the courts, and the seized amounts are destroyed with the court permission in Dompe Sanitary Landfill site, which is being operated by the Central Environment Authority. Next slide, please. And the penalties, of course, under the National Environment Act, of course, has been limited to 10,000 rupees and 2 years maximum imprisonment. And in most of the cases, 10,000 rupees has been fined by the courts as the penalty. Next slide, please. And these are the certain figures that on the raids conducted by the Central Environment Authority island-wide during 2018, thereby 10,384 raids have been conducted, and out of that 810 violators were detected, and those were brought to the respective courts and they were prosecuted and finally fined 10,000 rupees each. Next slide, please. And in the last year even, we conducted the same amount of raid, that is nearly 10,485, and thereby we were able to, detect offenders of 724 violations were detected, and they were brought to the respective courts and they were fined. Next slide, please. And with regard to these companies, of course, we have raided altogether 42 manufacturing companies who are manufacturing all these lunch sheets and some other polythene banned products. And we seized 41 tons of lunch sheet through those raids with the assistance of Consumer Affairs Authority. And all the raided materials were destroyed with the court permission in the Dompey Sanitary Landfill site, because the Central Environment Authority is operating a sanitary landfill site in Dompey, and the court permitted us to destroy all these seized materials in the Dompey sanitary landfill site, so that there will be no any release of those seized material into the environment, and there is no any chance to contaminate the environment, as well as they are not releasing to the ocean environment, and also there's no chance to generate secondary micro pollutants out of the seized material. Of course, here I'll have to state that the raids are conducted in three stages. The first one is raiding manufacturing companies. Though the regulation has been published, there are still companies who are manufacturing these illegal polythene lunch sheet products in mass scale, especially in Western Province, Colombo and Gampaha. There are a lot of such factories, and in addition, we have found that some other factories in some other areas even, like Kurunagala, Kandy and Kegol, and some other factories in Gol even. So those are the places where the mass scale lunch sheet, polythene lunch sheet manufacturing facilities are being operated. So all the information are getting through certain modes to the CEA from the general public, as well as some other supporters to the CEA, and based on those information, we are conducting raids, especially on those illegal manufacturers. So in addition to manufacturers, we are conducting our raids to mass scale wholesale traders, especially this wholesale trade market is being operated in Colombo Peta and Peebles Park area. So the wholesale traders are also being raided by the Central Environment Authority with the assistance of Consumer Affairs Authority and the Sri Lanka Police. So all the stocks arrested by the CEA is produced to the courts and destroyed in accordance with the permission granted by the courts. And lastly, we are raiding the users. Users in the sense, not the private individuals, but the users we categorize as the commercial users, in the sense that the restaurants, hotels, and such other commercial places where polythene lunch sheets are being used to wrap the foods for takeaway purposes. And sometimes they use those lunch sheets on the plates to ease the cleaning purpose of those plates. So those are the three levels of raids that we are conducting. And in this year even, we are continuing the raids, but due to this corona pandemic, last few months we had to stop that raiding operations. Now from July, we recommence the raidings island-wide. Next slide, please. And with regard to this, the regulation number 2034 upon 37, that is regarding the use of polythene for decorative purposes for various political, social, and religious events, that we have already communicated with all the political parties, local authorities, district and seat organizers, and all the secretaries and the Commission of Elections, and we have requested them not to use the polythene as a decorative material for any political campaign. Now we can see the results. Now there are the all the most of the major political parties have already decided as a policy not to use such a polythene materials as their decorative materials in the political campaigns. Next slide, please. And with all the implementation of all the regulation for 2 years, now these are the results of those things in a nutshell. That HDP importation in 2017 was 39,524 metric tons, and it has been reduced due to regulation to up to 26,410. That is a 33% reduction of HDP material primary form importation. Those data we obtained from the Sri Lanka customs, and compared to the HDP, LDP importation has been a little bit increased because the HDP shopping bag has been replaced by the LDP shopping bag. So due to that reason, 26% increase of importation of LDP has been noticed. And also the as a total, the HDP LDP total impact due to this regulation is that there's a 2.3 increase in total importation of plastic primary form material into the country. So that there's a question on whether we are in success in implementation of the regulation, or whether these regulations are being towards the correct direction in the control of single-use plastic materials as well as secondary micropollutants. Next slide, please. Next slide. Yes. Now, in addition to implementation of this regulation, the Central Environment Authority, assists for post-consumer plastic waste reusing and recycling processes. The Central Environment Authority has granted technical and financial assistance for setting up post-consumer plastic waste material recycling centers, 10 centers in various places in the country. Corona, Morotu, and Putlam, there are 3 private sector plants which were assisted by the Central Environment Authority, assisted in the sense, and we have provided the polythene crushing machines as well as the washing machines to clean up the dirt, unclean the polythene and plastic waste before it is being crushed into a pellet form. And also there are some other plants operated by the local authorities, Balangoda, Mathara, Kandy, Kaduvela, Kurunagala, Badul, Anuradhapura, and Jaffna. All these plants are being operated at a certain scale, but I am not saying those are operated in the optimum scale in the government sector ones. But the private sector plants are being operated at the optimum scale. And also the CEA has assisted or monitored the certain other recycling centers for yogurt cups and the Tetra Pak plastic containers. Those are operated in Homagama and Kegol. And also the pet water recycling project also being operated by private sector. Where the capacity is 250 metric tons per month. And the CEA has taken action to install a pyrolysis plant as a pilot project whose capacity is 100 kilogram per hour in Pethiyakandha, Gampaha. Now plant has already been installed, but it is that the operation has to be commenced, and there's a certain public protest for that project, so that once this election period is over, project implementation will be commenced. And also there's another activity conducted by the CEA to promote the recycler, that is the registration process is being implemented and all the recycling entities are being registered in the CEA, and it is being published in the website for give the information for other other agencies to hand over their recyclable products to those agencies. And also there's a waste incineration plant in the Muthurajavela that capacity is 600 metric tons per day. Now the construction is almost completed. Now it will be commence very soon for generation of energy out of non-combustible plastic waste and some other waste materials other than the green garbage. And also that there's a sanitary landfill site established by the Central Environment Authority in Gampaha, Dompe, for filling of this disposal of this non-biodegradable waste material, inclusive of post-consumer plastic waste materials. And also there's another project conducted by the Megapolis to dispose of solid waste, that is Arwakkalu in Putlam district, where the capacity is 600 metric tons per day. Those are the infrastructure facilities to deal with this post-consumer plastic waste issue in the country. Next slide, please. And in addition to that, of course, the Ministry of Environment and the Central Environment Authority understood that there's a necessity to further strengthen the actions on plastic waste management. For that, of course, we both agencies joined together and drafted a national action plan for plastic waste management based on several principles and basically 3R waste hierarchy. In this action plan, waste prevention reduction also been addressed, and reuse of plastic waste. The target is to achieve 30% of reuse rate by 2023. And recycling of plastic waste, thereby plastic recycling industry to be profitable business, providing high quality recycled products in a healthy, environmental friendly manner. Now the issue of recycling post-consumer plastic waste in the country, the economics. In due to the fluctuation of crude oil in the market, of course, the price of primary form of plastic material is being also fluctuating, so that the fixed price for the recycled plastic material cannot be assured in the local market. That is the main issue that local recyclers being faced. And recovery from non-recyclables, that is the waste to converting the waste materials into energy, that was one of the element addressed in the action plan. And lastly, to achieve 0% plastic discharge to the landfill sites by 2030. So that means recycling or converting those materials into energy by 2030. Those are the basic elements that we can notice in the National Action Plan for Plastic Waste Management drafted by the Ministry of Environment as well as the Central Environmental Authority. Next slide, please. And actually, there's an obstacle for managing this secondary micropollutants as well as this single-use plastic. That the obstacle is that certain there's a direction issued by the Consumer Affairs Authority under the Act number 9 of 2003. That is the direction number 26. There it says acting that the Consumer Affairs Authority directs all the traders that no trader shall at the time of selling of goods to the consumers, levy any on consumer for any bag wrapper issued to the consumer. So that means that all the traders has to issue a certain kind of a wrapper or bag to the consumer to, wrap or carry their goods. So that is the main obstacle that the CEA is facing to control the polythene bag issue in the country. So that is why we had to allow that LDP shopping bag by that particular regulation. Anyhow, now the CA is in the process of getting that particular order revised through the Supreme Court to remove that obstacle to controlling that single-use plastic issue. Next slide, please. And there are by understanding the present obstacles and the limitations of the penalties available in the National Environment Act, now we are in the process of amending the National Environment Act to bring the stringent penalties for the violators. So that present the penalty is just 10,000 rupees. That is not quite adequate for the large-scale polythene lanchine manufacturers. So that it's nothing really for the such large-scale factories as well as for the wholesale traders operated in the PETA and some other suburban places. And the fine will be increased up to 100,000 for the first time. And if the same person is continuing the offense, the second time the fine will be 200,000 rupees. And also the closure order also could be obtained to close that particular activity, maybe a trade or manufacturing entity. And also the CEA has introduced certain provisions to the proposed amendment of the NEA to introduce extended producer responsibility. That is the producer or the manufacturer is responsible for their own waste material, the wrapping or some, whatever the materials which are going to the customer to collect back and manage it by the manufacturer. So that is the principle that is being implemented in some other countries where there are a lot of market-based instrument or certain other some various type of tools are being used in some other countries to execute this extended producer responsibility by the manufacturers as well as the other large-scale multinational companies. So once we brought this extended producer responsibility, we think that most of the burden on the government of controlling this type of post-consumer plastic waste management will be again reversed back to the producers themselves. Next slide, please. And also the CEA is in the process of submitting a cabinet paper to the next cabinet to prohibit certain selected plastic items which are being caused secondary microplastics as well as the primary microplastics. So that I have listed out a few such items to be suggested through the cabinet paper to be banned. That is single-use lunch boxes, cups, stirrers, straws, plates, yogurt and ice cream spoons, cutleries made out of polythene plastics, and inflatable toys except balloon and balls and water floating toys, personal care products containing microplastics and plastic microbeads, and also making mandatory to display the mark of plastic type. You know that there are certain marks to identify the type of plastic starting from 1 to 7. And in most of the plastic packaging material, we notice that manufacturers are not displaying the plastic type, so that recyclers and the reusers has faced many difficulties in identifying the type of plastic, since there's no any symbol that is the internationally accepted symbol, but in the local producers do not display the symbol. So that recyclers cannot identify the type of plastic, and they are in a technical difficulty when they recycle those post-consumer plastic types. So that is why we wanted to make it as mandatory requirement to display the mark of plastic type, especially in the plastic packaging. And lastly, multiple plastic accessories used in the processing and offering of hot foods also being to be banned. So that in our kitchens, of course, a lot of plastic utensils are being used to, sometimes prepare hot foods and also serve hot foods. So that that also has been proposed as a banned item. Next slide, please. And those are the things I'll have to share with you with regard to the present laws and the proposed strategies to control the secondary and the primary microplastics as well as the single-use plastic issue in the country. So once again, I thank Sri Lanka Medical Association for inviting the Central Environmental Authority as and also to giving us this opportunity to share our views with this audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gamage. Very, very informative talk. A small suggestion or a small point I would like to ask from you. Can't we just go for this paper bags to be issued at the food cities rather than issuing a plastic or wrapping material when we are buying food from or food or any item from the food cities? Since the Valachena paper factories are also coming up, can't we go for something like that?
Yes, it's possible. And other than this plastic bag, of course, plastic bag as well as the plastic lunch eat, there's another alternative made out of polylactic acid. Polylactic acid in the sense it's a polymer made out of natural materials in the sense that starch, I mean, extracted out of manioc, wheat and some other grains. So those PLA is a very good alternative for manufacturing of lunch eats as well as the bag as a replacement of present polythene or plastic lunch eat or bag. But still this alternative products is available in the market, but the question is the price. The price of these PLA products are compared to very high with the plastic material. There is the main issue in the market is an economic factor, but the if the government is giving some sort of subsidy or some sort of tax concession for this PLA or whatever the biodegradable plastic material, that will be benefited to the country in the case of controlling these single-use plastic items as well as the micropollutant issue. And the other thing is about this paper bag, paper also being available as an alternative in the market, and certain some other companies are practicing issuing paper bags to their customers. And for the other large scale food supermarkets also can practice the same once it is available in the market at a low price. The price is the biggest issue with regard to this issuing all these alternative materials. There's no any other material in the local market which has a very low price compared to this plastic bag. There is a main issue in the country, really.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Gamage. So we'll move on to the next speaker, Professor Mahesh Jayaveera from Department of Civil Engineering, University of Morotua. He will talk about the removing of microplastics from the environment. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can you share the screen? Okay, thank you. So it has now come to the engineers to, you know, just contribute towards, you know, removing microplastics. So usually the engineers are the people who do look at how to remove most of these contaminants from drinking water. But today I'm concentrating on particularly drinking water because that is one of the areas which is, you know, emerging in engineering field. But go to the next slide. Yes, most of what I have put here, so others have already discussed. But one thing that we need to know is because of this issue, which is, I would say, emerging, no governmental legislation, standard, or at least guideline has yet emerged. So therefore, being engineers, we don't know as to what level we should get ourselves involved in removing microplastics. That is one of the major drawbacks we have had at the moment. And also we have another drawback that we don't know yet what would be the health hazard or the impact that is going to, you know, cause simply by drinking water with different size classes of microplastics. So therefore, that is quite important because for us to, you know, give you the better solution to remove microplastics, we should know the levels or maybe the classes that we need to remove. Now say, for example, whether the 5 microplastics micromilliliter is enough in 1 liter of water. We don't know yet. So therefore, in the world, people have come up with quite a lot of different schools of thoughts. So therefore, there is no uniform, I would say, efforts in getting these microplastics removed. Next. So therefore, the people have started working in removing most of these microplastics quite recently. If you look at what people have done, because in Sri Lanka, we don't have done, in fact, anything to remove microplastic because it has not been in our mandate, particularly with the National Water Supply and Drainage Board. Because if there is no legislation, if there is no guideline, so nobody knows whether it is required to be removed or not. But there is a common consensus now among the world that we should remove the microplastics from drinking water. But what has been practiced now in the world is what is called mainly the conventional treatments like coagulation. But membrane separation or the membrane filtration is not yet common in Sri Lanka, but it's quite common in other parts of the country. So therefore, we basically consider the general removal, but that particular treatment, or we usually call the conventional treatment, is not meant for the removal of microplastics. But we do remove so many other contaminants simply by having this conventional treatment. That is what even National Water Supply and Drainage Board does. But we have limitations. So because of the limitations, we don't know to what level we should remove. So that has to come from, I would say, the general medical practitioners, because they are the people who should tell us, okay, so when you just gulp or maybe ingest this amount of microplastics or nanoplastics, then there are some issues. Then we can be able to plan. So then we have a threshold level to which we could target. So without that, right at the moment, many people are doing, it looks like basically groping in the dark. Everybody tries to remove, but there is no consensus, as I mentioned earlier, among the engineers. Next slide. But still, what is important is to, you know, understand the level of treatment that we need to achieve. So therefore, when you look at, there are quite a lot of different, publication that you can be able to, you know, find. And some paper says that the plastic in water samples could range from 0 to 62 particles per liter, right? With an average of 5.42. So therefore, our question is, are we to target exactly, I would say, less than 10? Or do we have to go for another, you know, order of magnitude like 100 or 1,000? Still, we don't know. People do remove sometimes 100, sometimes thousands. So therefore, it's very important for us to, you know, come to a consensus with more research. But unfortunately, due to the lack of the research, so everybody is working, I would say, in isolation to remove whatever possible. So therefore, usual practice is we look at what would be the levels that are present in raw water, and then what would be the levels that should be present in treated water. Without knowing these two boundaries, it is difficult for us to, you know, go for an exact method of removal. But what we do right at the moment is, you know, the engineers, scientists have, you know, launched different techniques to remove to different levels. So therefore, we have had the different efficiencies in removing the microplastics from drinking water. Next slide. Okay, so if you look at this, very clearly given that there are a lot of research have been done, and it says bottled water has like 6,292 particles per liter in single use in PET plastic bottles, whereas treated water has 628 particles per liter from a plant, and the tap water, what you get, you know, for the drinking, potable water has 9.24 particles per liter. What does it say is we specifically do not treat for the microplastics when we give you the water, but our conventional treatment system itself helps remove different sizes of microplastics. So therefore, that is an added advantage we are getting now. But the question is this 9.24 particles per liter is going to cause any health hazard? Nobody knows yet. So therefore, that's why we need a lot of research towards that, because the health impacts is quite important for us to develop the technologies. Next. If you look at the technologies that are available in the world up to now, the very first is traditional drinking water treatments. Right at the moment, we have 4 studies in the world, and even we get only handful set of treatment case studies in the world, because people just started working on treatment of microplastics, particularly in the drinking water. Then comes the electrocoagulation. I'll go one by one later. And then the magnetic extraction and the membrane separation is quite famous in many countries. And what comes very recently in South Korea, they're quite good in microbubble ozonation. So therefore, for the time being, we have only these 5 techniques that are applicable, but they have not been fully endorsed by the organization, because there are pros and cons of each and every. Let's go to the next. Okay, so when you go for the traditional water treatment plant, everybody knows that this is what we do in our water treatment plants. We have primary, secondary, and tertiary treatments, which are quite good enough to remove the particles, and the removal efficiency is very, if you look at very clearly, you could see that it goes more than 90%. But the question is level. Still, we don't know the nanoparticles, what would be the amount, or maybe let's say the particles that should remain in drinking water, nobody knows. Some people argue saying that it should be less than 10. Some people argue saying that it could go even up to 100. So we don't know exactly what would be the actual level. Now, if you look at here, the levels are much less than 10. So usually we believe that it's actually a rule of thumb only. What we can believe is if it is going to be less than 10 particles per liter, so you have achieved what you should achieve, right? That is with traditional water treatment. Go to the next. Then comes the electrocoagulation, because people believe that traditional methods would not remove nano-sized particles. Because the problem is when the nanoparticles goes into the body and it can, transfer through the bloodstreams. So therefore, there are some issues that have been now identified with the nanoparticles. So if you are to remove the nanoparticles, the conventional treatment would not be sufficient. So in such a case, we need to go the coagulation. We look at this, what it says is you have an anode cathode, but you will be able to, give ionized elements which basically work as coagulants. And then the coagulants will make, you can see that the coagulants will bring plastics, smaller particles, bigger particles, and then with flocculation, they will settle. So therefore, these very small particles, ultimately what you do is you make bigger particles, so that because of its own weight, because of the gravity, they settle to the bottom. So that is the method by which we remove, the microplastics and particularly nanoparticles through the method called electrocoagulation. This has been tried only in 2 countries yet. We have only 2 case studies up to now in the world. And I'm talking of the accepted studies. Only 2 studies have been, given for the electrocoagulation is concerned. Go to the next. Then comes the magnetic extraction. So people still believe that even with electrocoagulation, you may not be able to capture, major, particularly the nano level particles. So therefore, then the engineers need to work on another method by which we can capture the nano sized particles, including macro, for which what is important is you can now develop what you call the zero valent nanoparticles, ion particles, and they can be modified, right? And once you modify the nanoparticles, they just go and then pick up all the nano microplastics. So that is what you see in the second picture. And that then what you do is, since iron has the property of magnetism, and using a magnet, you can be able to remove, iron coated nano or even macro particles. So that is the method we use to remove. This method is quite good in removing nanoparticles. So therefore, if you want, you can be able to, you know, go even less than one particle per liter with this technique. But unfortunately, this technique is pretty expensive. It's not that easy for you to do it. So since it is expensive, the use of this in a comprehensive manner is a questionable. So therefore, and also still this particular method is at experimental stage. So therefore, it may take some time for us to, you know, come out with a good technique with using the magnetic extraction method. Next one. Okay, so this is quite popular. Everybody knows that we have been using, reverse osmosis methods, microfiltration, nanofiltration, ultrafiltration, so all sort of filtration techniques are there. But if you are to go to the plastics, you need to go for reverse osmosis. But in this case, the issue here is whenever you remove a nano level particles, the membrane fouling takes place. That is one of the challenges that the engineers need to play. Because when you have a nanoparticles, particularly a nano level, they become a very hard material around the membrane. So therefore, the removal of this, material which is hardened on the membrane is very, very difficult. So therefore, what will happen? Usually then you have to, increase the pressure and most of the membranes are going to be torn apart. So therefore, the time or the lifespan of these membranes become less and less. So therefore, those are the challenges that people have, faced with. And still, we have not used the membrane separation specifically for microplastics, right? Because that comes as an additional advantage, because usually membrane separations are used to remove the other contaminants, like emerging contaminants that are coming out. We use membrane separation, but not in Sri Lanka, but in the other countries. So therefore, still I would say this has not been properly experimented to remove microplastics. Next. This is the most newest technique and seems to be quite cheap. So therefore getting very popular, particularly Japan, South Korea are very, very, they are ahead of all the others in testing this. What you do is you just try to produce micro bubbles or even the nano bubbles, right? We can be able to produce, and these bubbles, since they are ozonation, coming from ozonation, and then they are going to, just adhere to microplastics. Not only micro, even the nano, through what you call this hydrophobic addition. So because of this, and all the bubbles, when they come up, they bring all the particles, what you can find in the drinking water. So therefore, on the top, you get all the microplastics and nanoplastics. And then what we do is we just scrape it off. And that is how we are going to, remove the microplastics or nanoplastics from the drinking water. This method seems to be very promising. And many people are working on this to remove microplastics. So the only thing is still we don't have a commercialized plant. So everything is in the experimental stage. We have not yet got any commercial plant for the microbubbling in the world yet. Next. Okay, so the most important things we need to come back, because the microplastics are ubiquitous in this drinking water. So therefore, it's very important for us to come up with a policy, because even in Sri Lanka, we don't have anything. So we don't know what to do, though there is a school of thought saying that we should work on this, but to what level? So therefore, I think it's high time for the ministries to come out with policies to combat this upcoming problem. And also it's quite important for us to, make sure that you go for alternative materials, like what Mr. Gamage mentioned, starch, cellulose, lignin. So all of these materials could be used instead of plastic, so that the conversion to microplastics is going to be very much less. In addition, it's quite important for us to, do the risk analysis of ingestion of micro and nanoplastics, because we don't know still the exact the health risk that are associated with ingestion of microplastics. So therefore, these are the areas which are lacking, and I do believe that the governments need to work towards achieving some results for this one. So therefore, the removal would also be improved, you know, with answers for these burning questions. Next. Okay, so for the conclusion, I just want to say that there are no still a single method available in Sri Lanka, right? Nobody has done any method to remove microplastics in drinking water, right? Because that was not in our mandate yet. But people have just started, now we started in our university working, but we are not yet come up to that level. So therefore, people just started working on this. And despite the potential health risk, you know, the humans are not yet understood. So therefore, that is another problem that we have had. The occurrence in drinking water should not be ignored. Even though it is not identified, we should not ignore. So we have to, you know, work, you know, hard in removing these microplastics. So that we are mandated to do so, though it is not the legally mandated. And finally, just want to say to you that drinking water treatment plants have to face the problem of this microplastics, you know, now, at least in some places, because this poses a new threat to the human health. So therefore, that is one of the new emerging contaminants that have come on us. So we need to, you know, work towards achieving that. Okay, right. Next. Okay, so that's all I have to, you know, tell you basically. So therefore, I mean, in summary, what I want to say to you is this particular, you know, the topic is still at its infancy. So we are struggling, and then we are trying hard to see whether we can be able to come up with some, you know, successful methods. But as it is not yet mandated legally, the thing is, everything, you know, go very slowly. That's all I have to say, share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the thought-provoking speech. And I just want to ask a small question, sir.
Yes.
Do we have any equipments or techniques if somebody wants to bring a sample of water and check how much of microplastic are there, the concentration levels? Do we have the facilities in Sri Lanka to do that?
We have. That is, what you have to do is you need to separate. There are certain methods by which you separate. It has been very clearly given. So you need to use like sodium chloride first. So, and then after washing it, then you need to do what you call this oxidation techniques, advanced oxidation with hydrogen peroxide plus Fenton reaction. And that is to dissolve all the organic compounds. And then you wash it thoroughly, and then only you get this. And then you have to use FTIR technique to select what plastic is there. There are 28 types of plastics available. 28. We have observed 28. It's not an easy job.
Yeah.
So you need to identify all of them. And once you identify, then only you can be able to do. But when it comes to water, for us, there is one thing very easy, because we get fibrous form. Mm-hmm. We are looking at basically fibers. We are not looking at other shapes. It is most of the time fibers that matters when it comes to the final drinking.
Yeah.
Okay.
So another small thing. If a private company or an institution or a person who's manufacturing plastic water, the drinking water, if they want to get a quality assurance for their product, will they be able to pay and do some sort of a test and
not at all in Sri Lanka, except when you go to Stintec, you can be able to say we published using this PET bottles. You won't believe, whenever you use PET bottles under different conditions, inside it is going to be torn off and the microplastics will come out into the water.
Yeah.
Right? And including phthalates. So unfortunately, this has not been, you know, regulated yet. Because the problem for me is actually there are no special areas, or maybe I would say laboratories, where we can get it done properly unless you go outside.
Yeah.
So because you need to go to very, very, you know, small levels, And you need a couple of, you know, different techniques, and like TEM analysis, SEM analysis, and FTIR analysis, for you to, you know, exactly tell what has happened, which we did it actually with the help of other people. But it's going to be very, very laborious.
And also, sir, for the betterment of the listeners, sure. If somebody wants to conduct a research or a MSc or a PhD, will yes. there be any chances at your university
exactly.
for them exactly. to come up?
We would be happy to, you know, do, you know, different disciplines to bring together. So yeah. that would, you know, help us come out a good resource, because our biggest problem right at the moment is all engineers do research alone. But why not, you know, discuss and then join to do with, you know, medical practitioners?
Yeah.
I would believe that would be a very, very good idea.
Yeah, that's a very good idea, sir.
Sure.
So today, the next speaker was from Mass Holdings, but unfortunately he has to leave because there's another meeting. Mr. Anil Vitarna, the Chief Information Officer from Mass Holdings, he was supposed to tell us about that famous turtle T-shirt that they have developed for the Sri Lankan team using this plastic recycling. And because of that, he has to leave the session. And I would like to invite anyone who's having any problems or questions to use the raise hand option and ask from the expert panel and get your doubts clarified, or else we can conclude the session if you all don't have any questions. Now is the question time. Yes, Amila. Amila? Vihanga, can you unmute Amila?
Yes,
yes, Amila.
Hello, sorry for my kid is crying. So, my question is to Dr. Mahesh Jaivila. So I think he mentioned like Sri Lanka has facilities to analyze microplastic. So do we have a micro FTIR or micro Raman spectrophotometer kind of?
Yes, we have the Raman, FTIR at IFS in Kandy. We have one, right? But I got myself, I got everything done in fact, China. I didn't do here. I got my stuff actually done in Kandy. Not only that, even the TEM analysis, because only with the TEM analysis, you can say what will happen to your surfaces. Inner surface, how it, you know, changes. Morphological characteristics, you can tell only that. So that also I did it in, China, because in Sri Lanka, I have not seen anything. I was told that it is available in Slintech, but I have not got that opportunity.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Sure.
So maybe we also can help in that kind of analytical work. So that's why.
Good.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes. Any other questions? Yes, Dr. Fidas.
Behalf of me, actually, one of our staff members are also here.
We can't hear you properly, Mr. Dr. Fidas.
Miss Himali from our faculty, actually she got a question, so through me, so she's going to ask. So go ahead, Miss Himali.
My question is directed to Mr. Himali from Central Environmental Authority.
The voice is not clear.
My question is directed to Mr. Nimal Gamge from Central Environmental Authority.
Mr. Nimal, are you with us at the moment?
Yes. So, Mr. Nimal, now we heard about this action plan for plastic mitigation. And what I got from that is you are basically concentrated on the single-use plastics and basically the usage of plastic by, the day-to-day use. But when we talk about the ocean pollution, the plastic pollution in ocean, it's, of course, 80% of plastics, they are coming from the land, but there is a 20% of plastics that are added from the sea-based activities, for example, shipping and fishing, that kind of practices. And I would like to know if you have any kind of plan to add those sorts of activities to manage, for example, if you talk about ghost fishing, like abandoned, lost and discarded fishing gear, the plastics that are added from that, how are you going to manage this problem, especially the plastics that have been added by fish shipping and fishing based activities?
Yeah, I will direct the question towards Mr. Gam again. I will send an answer to you to Dr. Pyrus in a email form. Eh? Okay. I think Mr. Gamage, I don't think we can contact him at the moment. Any other questions?
Hello?
Hello, Mr. Gamage.
Ah, Sajit, yes. Basically, this plan addresses land-based plastic pollution, I mean that post-consumer plastic waste. And this plastic waste management action plan, there's a point in addressing the ocean plastic pollution because of this, abundant fish nets that also be there in the action plan, so that the particular ministry also has the responsibility on that implementation of that particular action on due to this abundant fish nets, that also there as an element in the action plan. Because this action plan has three sections. The first one is prevention and reduction, thereby six goals are there, namely gradual ban of identified list of single-use plastics, reduce burning of plastic waste, 30% reduction of plastic in packing by 2023, a reduction of marine plastic and microplastic 80% in 2025. In that, that is the goal number four. There are, of course, actions has been identified to be implemented by the particular minister in charge of that fishing and marine resources.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Gamage. Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, I've got a question. Hi.
Yeah.
Hi. I'm Alfred Pereira. I'm a Sri Lankan living in England. So I was just wondering, are there any cases of plastics or microplastics actually causing cancer? So are there any case reports on that you've seen?
Now the thing is, there are some evidence not in Sri Lanka, but they are in the literature. They have shown certain chemicals are directly related or indirectly related to the cancers. But in Sri Lanka, of course, for my knowledge, there are no case reports reported, because it's an area that we need to do a lot of research work. In Sri Lanka, since it is at the beginning stage or the infancy stage, this microplastic topic, even though the other countries have gone into details in microplastic, but now only a few years back, only the Sri Lanka has started this process.
Yeah.
So we need to work on that.
So presumably there's not really very much research looking at the relatedness of microplastics in the environment and prevalence of mental illness and dementia. I mean, I work as a child psychiatrist in Oxford Health. So just wondering.
Yeah. At the moment, we are looking at the tip of the iceberg. We don't know what is underneath that.
Yeah, so when I look at my sear fish curry, I can anticipate there are at least nine particles per liter or whatever.
Yeah.
Right. But has anyone done any research on the regular evening meal? How much is in that?
Yeah, it's pretty much scary. Yeah, that's why from Sri Lanka Medical Association, we got down all the parties to a common forum to fight against these microplastics, and especially the education ministry. To start the battle from the school level, because it's very easy to change the mindset up of the children against this plastic. So rather than changing the mindset up of the adults.
Yes. So in the way that Sri Lanka is winning the battle against COVID, you're going to win the battle against microplastics.
Yes. Yeah. Hopefully.
That's the idea. Yeah.
Thank you very much for joining.
No worries.
And so with the time, we will conclude the session. With this, we will conclude the session of microplastics in Sri Lanka and the human health. I'm very much thankful to Dr. Kitsiri from NARA, Dr. Fires from the Ocean University, Professor Mahesh Jaivira from the University of Morotua, Mr. Gamage from Central Environmental Authority, Dr. Madhura from Education Ministry, and Mr. Ranil Vitharna from Mass Holdings for joining with us. And we will be start writing a small report on this webinar, and we will publish it soon. And we are hoping to collaborate with all the authorities, Sri Lanka Medical Association, and to work towards the battle against the microplastics, and hope we can at least save Sri Lankans if we change the mindset up, and we will reduce the plastic from our drinking water and the waste management. By doing those things, we will try to save our future generations also. Thank you for joining with us with the Sri Lanka Medical Association, this pre-Congress workshop, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.